Good morning. Welcome to Manhattan Beach Community Church. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. My name is Mark Pettis, and I am privileged to serve as senior minister here at MBCC. And I welcome you this morning on behalf of myself, on behalf of Reverend Matthew Baugh, and on behalf of our worship assistant this morning, Jeff Caldwell. We have kind of a special Sunday of sorts this morning as we give all of the children in our church Bibles this morning. It's a new thing we're going to be doing from now on. There are a couple things I want to mention just kind of at the front end here. First, if you would look on in the edges of the pews, we have blue-covered pew books, and I would invite you to find those and sign those and send them to the other end of the pew and then bring them back to the middle. That would be great. I wanted to mention that this Thursday at 10 a.m., we will be having a senior coffee here at the church, and I think there's information in your bulletin about that, but it starts at 10 a.m., and it is down in the fireside room, and welcome those who would like to come for that. In your bulletin, we have this new screen thing, which you'll see soon if you haven't been here before and seen it, and there was some conversation last week around having hymns that are listed in the bulletin that don't give an indication of what number they are in the hymnal. So the hint is this, we're going to do this for a little while. If it's only going to be on the screen and you won't be able to find it in the hymnal, it's now going to say screen only in your bulletin. And we're going to do that for a little while, and if people like that, that's fine. Otherwise, we're going to move on and assume people will figure that out over time. But the first hymn is, so we have two of those today, and our hymn of welcome for all the children is one that is relatively new to us. We sang it last week. We're singing it for 8 straight weeks, so as you come and sing it more often, you'll be more comfortable with it, so I'm feeling confident for you all that it is something we can pick up, and be reassured the choir actually does have the music, and so they're going to be blasting it out for you to kind of help us along on that hymn. And the second one, I felt pretty strongly that I wasn't worried about giving you the music to John Lennon's Imagine. I figure you can follow along with that one. The screen will have the words. So that's for you all. I wanted to follow up on one thing from last week. After church, we did a little bit of a survey. Apparently, we did something a little different last week that we'd never done before. The dunk tank went over very well. Now, it really isn't in our budget to have a dunk tank every week. But we did discuss, for immediate sermon feedback, starting soon we'll have buckets of cold water in the narthex so you can, you know, douse us on the way out. You know, finding a happy medium between those things. Jeff.
Good morning and welcome. There will be a large donation needed for the dunk tank, though, after every Sunday morning. It's not a free thing that you get to do. Welcome. This morning we have a number of congregational currents going on, but in the idea of brevity, because there is so much activity this morning within our service, let me just highlight a couple of them quickly for you. Coming up on the 28th, something that I'm participating in is the Young Dads MBCC Casino Night in conjunction with Sandy Hook Promise and MiraCosta High, all the proceeds going to benefit both those school programs and the charity foundation. It'll be a great evening of poker, Pai Gow, which is a really fun game if you haven't tried it yet, blackjack, and we'll also have a craps table as well as live entertainment and an auction as well. It's a huge fundraiser, and it's a tremendous amount of fun, and we look forward to seeing all of you there. Also coming up, the Extensions Board will be hosting a free parenting workshop for the community entitled Raising Capable Children, and that comes up on Wednesday the 25th at 7:30 p.m. downstairs in our assembly hall. And if you look over the insert, there are a number of other congregational currents happening with the Shipmates and the Mariners, the choirs, and also coming up with the theater, the production of Bus Stop in October. So for further information, I direct you to look in that way. And for that, I turn it back over to the still dry Mark.
Still dry. The one thing I will say about the casino night piece is that today, I believe, is the deadline for the early bird ticket prices. So I would suggest if you're thinking about it, today is the day to go online and buy your tickets and come and support an important cause in our community and for our community. Each Sunday, we gather as a community to worship God, to reconcile ourselves with God through worship, through prayer together, through singing together, through gathering as a community. But we first start by reconciling with one another. And in our congregation, we do that through the tradition of passing the peace. And at this time, I would invite all of us to turn to those around us and offer a word of peace.
will notice in your bulletins this morning, we are on the call to worship. Please join me in our call to worship this morning. God calls us to acknowledge our blessedness and our privilege. God encourages us to be the church. God calls us to encourage the smallest among us to stand tall. God encourages us to be the church. Meet us, O God, in this hour. Show us what it means to be your church. Amen. There's a prayer that I came across a few years back by a theologian from the earlier 20th century. And his name was Thomas Merton, and I've reflected on this many times individually throughout the week. I'll pull this up as a reminder to myself, and it's something that has had a profound resonance for me and for the people who introduced me to it. It goes, "My Lord God, I have no idea where I am going. I do not see the road ahead of me, and I cannot know for certain where it will end. Nor do I really know myself. And the fact that I think I am following your will does not mean that I am actually doing so. But I believe that the desire to please you does in fact please you, and I hope that I have that desire in all that I am doing. I hope that I will never do anything apart from that desire. And I know that if I do this, you will lead me by the right road, though I may not know anything about it. Therefore, will I trust you always, though I may seem to be lost in the shadow of death. I will not fear, for you are ever with me, and you will never leave me to face my perils alone." Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. It's me again. This morning you'll find the scripture reading in your Bibles on pages 821 and 822. It's Mark 9:33 through 37 and 42. And I'll give you just a moment to search for that. I always find when I am sitting in the pews and trying to, it takes me forever to get to page 800 in the Bible. Flipping around, they're really thin pages. I always end up somewhere in the 1000s or the 700s. I'm like, where is 800? But by this time, is that better? Oh, I'm sorry. You guys just missed a whole wonderful little soliloquy that I did. Man, it was so funny. That was great. Should I go back to the beginning? Let's all do the call to worship together. This morning's scripture reading, page 933. Thank you, David, for bringing that to my attention. Mark 9:33 through 37, 42, in the New Revised Standard. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be the first must be the last of all and servant of all." Then he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me. If any of you put a stumbling block before me, but before one of these little ones who believes in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea." We also have a poem this morning in honor of our celebration of children and the Bibles. This poem is by Ina Hughes, and it's called "We Pray for Children." We pray for children who sneak popsicles before supper, who erase holes in their math workbooks, who can never find their shoes. And we pray for those who stare at photographers from behind barbed wire, who can't bound down to the street in a new pair of sneakers, who never counted potatoes, who are born in places where we wouldn't be caught dead, who never go to the circus, who live in an X-rated world. We pray for children who bring us sticky kisses and fistfuls of dandelions, who sleep with cats and bury goldfish, who hug us in a hurry and forget their lunch money, who squeeze toothpaste all over the sink, who slurp their soup. And we pray for those who never get dessert, who have no safe blanket to drag behind them, who watch their parents, watch them die, who can't find any bread to steal, who don't have rooms to clean up, whose pictures aren't on anybody's dresser, whose monsters are real. We pray for children who spend all their allowance before Tuesday, who throw tantrums in the grocery store and pick at their food, who like ghost stories, who shove dirty clothes under the bed and never rinse out the tub, who get visits from the tooth fairy, who don't like to be kissed in front of the carpool, and who squirm in church or temple and scream in the phone, whose tears we sometimes laugh at and whose smiles can make us cry. And we pray for those whose nightmares come in the daytime, who will eat anything, who will never have seen a dentist, who aren't spoiled by anybody, who go to bed and cry themselves to sleep, who live and move but have no being. We pray for children who want to be carried, and for those who must, for those we never give up on, and for those who don't get a second chance, for those we smother, and for those who will grab the hand of anybody kind enough to offer it. We pray for children. Amen.
as the choir is making their way out, I would like to invite Sylvia and Jackson and Matthew up here, and we'll get to inviting the kids really soon. So we'll just be patient with us. Be patient with us. And of course, Jackson sat as far back as he possibly could. Here you go. I've got a mic in my. Today's scripture, we heard, reminded us that when we welcome a child, we not only welcome that child, we welcome Christ, and we welcome God. In our congregation, we welcome children in many different ways. One of the most important ways we do is by welcoming them, recognizing that they are children. There are cards in your pew pockets that speak to our values in terms of welcoming children. The idea that we welcome them as they are, with their wiggles, with their questions. We love their questions. Their questions are questions we all have. And we welcome our children in a way that shares with them our sacred stories, our traditions, our history. And this morning, we get to do it in a very special way, as for the very first time, we welcome our children by presenting them with a Bible of their own at their age level. Three different Bibles to give out. So this morning we are excited to welcome them in that way.
To our students in fifth grade to eighth grade, we give the Action Bible, which tells the sacred stories of the Bible through comic book illustrations done by comic book artists. Using this modern-day method of storytelling helps to bring these stories to life in a way that our fifth to eighth graders will understand. Please come up.
Come on up. If you're fifth, fifth through eighth grade, come on up now. Get a couple more. If you are in first through fourth grade, come on up now. There you go. I'm going to need the display one. And for our pre-K and kindergartners, we have the Desmond Tutu Children of God Story Bible. It is a wonderful collection of stories from the Bible with illustrations, very rich illustrations showing pictures from artists from around the world. And so we'd like to invite our littlest ones up at this time. Hey, guys. For you, and that's for you, and that's for you. All right. Okay, you want to hold on to that? Oh, there you go, you got it. All right, gentlemen. Oh, we got more. Okay, good. Great. A couple more. Excellent. Here we go. want both hands. There you go. There you go. Thank you.
If you know a child who is not here today, please let me know. I do have extra Bibles, and we want to make sure that all of our kids have an age-appropriate Bible. All right, can you guys pray with me?
Yes.
God, we thank you for the curiosity of children. We thank you for the wiggles in the seats on Sunday mornings, the questions that though they may be many, and the joy of the children singing. As the disciples of your church, we renew our commitment to walk with the children of our church as they grow in their faith. As these children read these words and see the art found in these Bibles, we pray that they continue to listen for your still small voice behind the words and hold these sacred stories close to their hearts. We know you look with delight upon us today as we renew this commitment to read and remember you in these sacred stories. Help us to absorb its wisdoms and live its inspired truth. Amen. All right, you guys can go take your Bibles to your parents, and then we'll meet up in the courtyard for Sunday school.
So I'm going to take the Children of God storybook Bible home with me, okay, Sylvia? And then I'll have Thomas come get his. Yeah, great. As we prepare ourselves for a time of prayer together, I invite us to take a few moments to center ourselves in this space and in this time with perhaps a few deep breaths. As we breathe and bring ourselves into this time, we remember that looking out to the wider world, we pray today for the people of Argentina, Paraguay, and Uruguay. We pray for those in our nation who are in need, that their needs may be met, for our leaders, that they may make decisions based in wisdom and compassion. In our church community, we pray today for Steve, the family of Roger, family of Bob, for Caroline, for Charlotte. You invite us to, at this time, raise those names with our voices that are on our hearts if we are so moved. Join me in an attitude of prayer. Gracious and loving God, we are blessed by many things in our lives, and we are surrounded by the reminders of those blessings. On this day, as we place a special focus on our children, we offer our thanks for the blessing they represent in our families, in our church, in our community, and in our world. We ask you to help us to appreciate that blessing, to nurture the blessing. And we ask you to throw your arms around all the children of the world, that they may not be forgotten or silenced, that they may thrive. We ask healing for those in need, strength for those who who are feeling weak, a sense of purpose for those without a sense of where they are going, and a place in community for those who feel isolated. God, we thank you for what we have, and we pray that all of God's children may have what they need, may experience an abundance. We pray all of this in your most holy name, and in the Spirit of Christ that gathers us together. Amen.
Do for others and as others do for you. May you build a ladder to the stars and climb on every rung. May you stay forever young, forever young, forever young. May you stay forever young. May you grow up to be righteous. May you grow up to be true. May you always know the truth and see the light surrounding you. May you always be courageous. Stand upright and be strong. May you stay forever young, forever young, forever young. May you stay forever young. May your feet always be swift. May you have a strong foundation when the winds of changes shift. May your heart always be joyful. May your song always be sung. May you stay forever young, forever
He can still hear us, so let's thank him again. he's leaving the country soon, right? Rumor has it. So we caught him before he left. That was great. Thank you very much, Dylan. Will you join me in a moment of silent reflection on the themes of this morning in our thoughts of children? I'm guessing that the feeling of powerlessness seems like something we would only experience on occasion. And that is true for most of us. But when we take a step back, while we would like to believe that anyone can assert control, we know that there are many in our world who are truly powerless. People who lack agency, whose voices go unheard, who have little control over their circumstances. So to be honest, this sermon could go in any number of directions. This past summer, I was attending the General Synod of our church denomination, the United Church of Christ. And while I was there, I attended a dinner where the focus was children. And at the conclusion of the dinner, as a benediction, our Associate General Minister, the Reverend Tracy Blackman, read the poem that Jeff read this morning. And I must admit, I have not been able to get it out of my mind. And I don't believe it's because, or at least only because, I have a child of my own. Love the children is one of the three great loves upon which the wider church, the United Church of Christ, is focusing, along with love of neighbor and love of creation. One could argue that children could be included in the broader category of neighbor. Yet it seems to me to specifically identify the love of children as a priority. For our children face challenges that are unique. And I have come to believe that one of the most important things about what it means to be the church is that we are concerned with the well-being of children. Further, it seems to me that if we as the church are not working to make the lives of children better, then I wonder, what are we doing? So as I consider this idea of fighting for the powerless, I found myself circling back time and time again to children. For children live and thrive dependent on others to support them. Needing others to speak for them or to provide, to make space to speak for themselves. They are vulnerable to the whims of leaders and other adults who may not have their best interests at heart. When we speak of fighting for the powerless, we are often speaking of fighting for children. And my friends, I believe that we do a very good job of fighting for our own children and focusing on the well-being of the children in our lives. I see proud posts of parents and grandparents spending time with their children on Facebook, celebrating milestones, reveling in the opportunity to simply be together. I see the pride in their eyes in those pictures, whereas they recount a story about that child in a one-on-one conversation. And I've been on the other side of it as well, both posting things on Facebook and in person talking about my own child. We want what is best for the children in our lives without a doubt, and we are willing to fight tooth and nail for it. The manner in which we will go about it may differ, and there are many different parenting styles to be sure, yet I believe that all parents share the same basic approach when it all comes down to it. Motivated by the idea that we want what is best for them, we seek to set our children up to succeed. I remember fondly for the most part, the time in our lives when Thomas was first learning to walk. He had, as children do, learned to pull himself up, and he was just taking those very first steps. It was all at once exciting and frightening. As we looked about the house and saw all the things that he could fall over or on, all of the corners and surfaces upon which he might hit his head. We had a little saying, everything was fun and games until Thomas bonked his head. It was just about this time in our lives when we found ourselves up at Pilgrim Pines for an entire week with him. Pilgrim Pines is the church camp for our denomination in our conference up in the mountains, above Yucaipa. So we were in the mountains, on rocky paths, on hills like this. Friends, you can baby-proof your house, but you cannot bubble wrap the entire world. So there was a lot of hand-holding, and path-clearing, and countless times picking him back up. We did what we could to help him succeed and to grow, because that is what we do for our children. And here in the church, we do the same. Even in a privileged community such as ours, we know that there are many potential stumbling blocks. So we offer a full and vital faith formation program. We volunteer our time to assist in teaching and shepherding. We give out age-appropriate Bibles and provide myriad other resources. We offer special programming, both educational and social. And we support with our pledges a budget that provides various staff positions that work with and nurture our children. We have heard the message of Jesus contained within our passage, and we do our best to prevent or to remove the stumbling blocks that might impede their progress or prevent the success of our children. And even then, when we have made this effort, we know well that our children can still stumble, for that is part of learning. So we are there to pick them up, for we never stop trying. We want what is best for our children. We are tenacious for our children. But what about other children? Children that are not our own. What about children in adjacent communities? What about children in other states? What about children in other nations, even nations that are not our allies? What about children, in the words of the poet, who live and move but have no being? As we consider this theme of fight for the powerless as it relates to children, we must realize that the most powerless among children are those children who are not part of families or communities where they have advocates like us, where they do not have a support network as vast as the one that our children have. When we hear the call of our Christian faith to fight for the powerless, it is these other children for whom we are called to fight as well. Jesus makes clear in this morning's passage the priority we are to place on children. His culture, like ours, tended to cast children aside and underestimate what they might bring. Children were to be seen and not heard, and often not even to be seen. To suggest that children were among the powerless in his time as well would be fair, would be an accurate statement. Then Jesus, as Jesus does, turns the cultural expectations on their ear. He literally picks up a child and places that child in the midst of his disciples, as they're caught up in some absurd conversation about who among them is the most important, something that we adults have a tendency to do at times. And Jesus sets them straight with what is a powerful statement. Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me. And my friends, if this is what Jesus has to say on the matter, who are we to argue? As a self-purported follower of Jesus, who are we not to follow his example? To welcome a child is to welcome God. As I read it, this is not simply a call to choose one child and welcome him or her, then check it off the list and move on. It is a call to choose and welcome all children, to show respect and love for all children, and to do what we can to remove the stumbling blocks that lie in the paths of all children. For in each child is God. Again, like last week, this is a big ask. But as I said already, if we're not working to make the lives of children better, then I wonder, what are we doing? What are we doing if we welcome children and youth into our midst at church, and we do not offer them meaningful and fun experiences in faith formation, as well as opportunities to peer beyond the bubble into the wider world? What are we doing if we who live in a blessedly privileged community witness children in adjoining communities who are struggling academically, and who do not engage, and we do not engage to provide resources and support to help them succeed? What are we doing, we who are surrounded by abundance, when we see families with children in our wider community left without homes, left without food, and we do not step up to feed them and provide shelter? What are we doing if we, like the rest of our society, are devastated time and time again by the news of another senseless act of violence in our schools, resulting in the loss of lives, and we do not go beyond the thoughts and prayers to explore the ways that we can make a difference? My friends, these are among the many things we are doing here at MBCC. Through ministries and efforts like faith formation and youth, reading partners, project needs, family promise, and our young dads, there are people among us who are witnessing to our commitment to fight for the children here and in the wider community. It's a big ask, a tall order, but we can make a difference in the lives of children, and we know this because we are. But this is, after all, a sermon, and not an end-of-year celebration banquet. And as you might have come to expect in a sermon, I believe that there is more that we can do, more that we need to be doing. If we are truly to remove the stumbling blocks and demonstrate our love of children, to be the church God is calling us to be, we all need to make a priority. We must see the needs of all children, make that a priority, not just our own, and not just the children of those who look or think as we do. For my part, here in the church, I pledge to engage children and youth more fully into the life of our church through worship that includes their voices and not just on Youth Sunday, faith formation that seeks their wisdom, that invites questions and conversation, and through intergenerational fellowship that reminds us of the gift of community that we have here. But more than that, I pledge to explore the ways that we can fight for the children in our world, to always ask, how are we impacting children's lives in a positive and meaningful way, keeping in mind the impact our decisions have on those who are without a voice in the process, here in the church, in our community, and in the wider communities of which we are a part. And further, I will continue to use my privilege to enable and encourage the voices of the children to be heard. And I invite all of you to join me in this. Each of us has power that we can use to fight not only for our children, but for all children. And each of us has the opportunity to share that power in new ways. So let us be active advocates for children with our voices. Let us be strong supporters for children with our resources. Let us be absolute allies for our children, removing the stumbling blocks that lie in their path and setting them up for success. This, my friends, is what it means to be the church. For like Jesus, we are an extension of God's love, seeing with clear eyes the powerlessness of children, placing them in the midst of God's community, welcoming them, acknowledging them, acknowledging the presence of God within them, surrounding them with our love, and setting each and every child up for success so they may flourish. And as the church, we fight to make sure they always will. Amen.
Thank you.
I would like us to take a moment and give thanks. So this morning, Jacob is not here, and our fill-in person is in the back, and that person is Kevin Hefner. And Kevin is, as you might expect with all of the new things, it's kind of like drinking out of a fire hose. And he's working hard back there, and I'd like us to give him some appreciation for this effort. And I would invite you to find in your bulletin at this time the prayer of dedication, and let us share that together. O God, we receive so much from you, and for that we are thankful. Surrounded by such abundance, it can happen that we forget that others do not have enough. May this offering be blessed of our commitment to everyone has enough. Amen. Friends, there we are. Friends, we are all people who have power. Each of us has the power to make our lives and the lives of others better. As we go from this place, let us remember God's call to welcome our children, to love our children, and to set them up to succeed in all that they endeavor to do, showing them God's love each and every day. Amen.